Okay, so poker might be one of the most misunderstood games of all time. Most people think that to be good at poker, you need a great poker face so that your opponent can't read you when you're bluffing. As a pretty strong poker player myself, I can confirm that this is a large, large misconception about the game, and if I'm being completely honest, I find it holds a lot of people back from engaging in what is ultimately a really complex and engaging experience. So today, I'm going to pick apart what goes into making a great bluff and a terrible bluff in the game of poker. The cool thing about this video is that whether you're someone who barely knows the rules of poker, or if you're a dedicated poker reg, then this is a useful guide that you can use to implement at any table of any level of play. I know that for a lot of you guys, you're kind of locked indoors, so poker might be a fun thing to kind of test out, see if it's for you. So this guide is just kind of there to help you out, see if you're interested. I know for a fact that I've got advanced players watching, like BAP, as well as newer players like my buddy Jonii, so I want to make this video as accessible as possible. By the way, you should go sub to Jonii, he's kind of dope. What I've done is I've made a very simple checklist of 5 things to remember for any time that you decide you're going to try to bluff in a hand in poker. The nice things about these lessons is that they come neatly packed into this one hand that's played in the movie Casino Royale, between James Bond and his nemesis, the dreadfully calculating villain Le Chiffre. If you ever think about bluffing, you need to run this hand through your mind as an example of what not to do when bluffing. Because, how can I say this without being rude? Le Chiffre is a dumb ass. He's like really bad at poker. Don't listen to him. Let's dive into it. A great thing about this hand is that we are only ever informed of what Le Chiffre has, but his play is terrible regardless of what his opponents have. He's going to be bluffing with a pair of black twos, the color of which is going to be relevant later on in this hand analysis. The first thing we need to understand about this hand is the positions of the players at the table. The relevant players in this hand are Fukutu, Infante, Le Chiffre, and Bond. And while we don't know if any of them are in the blinds, we know that this will be the turn order for the remainder of the hand. The flop comes 9-8-5 of hearts. Fukutu and Infante both check, and Le Chiffre leads out with a bet of $50,000. And that's it. Yep, with that information alone, we can see what a terrible bluff this is for a number of reasons. Because the big blind has been previously established as $10,000 at this point in the tournament, and because most pre-flop bets range from 2 to 3 times the big blind, we can assume that the pot is somewhere between $80,000 to $120,000. By the way, if you're intimidated by these numbers, please don't be. They're not going to be super, super relevant to this analysis. We can't criticize Le Chiffre's bet sizing because we don't know the exact size of the pot. But what we can do is analyze his first mistake. He's bluffing on a very wet board. Even in a 1v1 scenario, there are so many decently strong hands that Bond could be continuing with. So any hand that has 2 hearts make a flush in this situation. Or any hand with a 9, such as 10-9, Jack-9 suited, any of these will be continuing, because they made top pair. He'll also likely be continuing with any straight draws involving something like Jack-10, as well as a queen, king, or ace of hearts, that could all improve down the line if he wants to go for a really strong flush draw. But what are the odds that Bond has any of those? If you're a newer player right now, you might be panicking. Oh god, do I have to remember all of these in my head? Not exactly. The fact of the matter is that the board is very connected, and they all have the same suit, so you know for the future that anytime you're playing, if you see a board like this, run away! Now's not the time to bluff! Even if somehow Bond doesn't have any one of those hands, it doesn't matter because there are 2 other players at the table. So even if you suck at math, you can piece together that someone is almost guaranteed to call your bluff here, which we don't want. The point of a bluff is to get people off of the table. So if your bluff doesn't achieve that, then don't do it. This leads to the second mistake that was made in this hand. Le Chiffre is bluffing when there are too many players in the hand. If the goal of a bluff is to get people off of their hands, then it stands to reason that the more players there are in a hand, the greater probability there is of someone having hit the board. Ergo, if there are multiple people in the hand, you should be very careful about when to bluff. On that subject, let's talk about information, and how it's possible to get more of it depending on when you're going to act in the hand. This leads to the third mistake that's being made here. Le Chiffre is bluffing out of position. Le Chiffre is playing before Bond, meaning that he doesn't have the opportunity to see whether Bond would have checked the flop, like the other guys did, or bet. This action that Le Chiffre is performing is called playing out of position. Basically, bluffing after every other player has already checked is smart because you have more information, whereas playing earlier in the hand is harder because you have less information. Good poker players play surprisingly honest most of the time. So even if Bond has a nothing this time around, we just don't know how well he's hit the flop. And while Fukutu and Infante have shown weakness, Bond hasn't given Le Chiffre any such indication. So if we're going for a bluff, doing so when you're the last to act is far more advantageous. Now, I'm not saying that you should never bluff when there are multiple players on the board, or the board is wet, or you're out of position. But if all three are happening at the same time, yeesh, jeez, please, no. Here we can see legendary poker icon Phil Ivey taking a large pot that on the surface looks very similar to our situation with Le Chiffre. The difference here is that Ivey is making his play when all the cards have been laid out, so that is to say, we have seen the flop, the turn, and the river. Furthermore, everyone has already checked the round twice. In other words, he has tons of information. That's the key difference between a pro and a goof. You have to be cognizant of the information that you have, not based on personal hunches and gut reactions and physical tells, but the actions that other players perform during the hand. Before we move on, I'd like to point out that Le Chiffre has neither liked nor subscribed to my channel, and we know that Le Chiffre is a kind of a prick. So don't be like Le Chiffre. Hit the subscribe button, give it a like, and you know, hit that little notification bell there. Ding-a-ling-a-ling. I don't upload that often, so you won't be driven to insanity with a little alarm going off. Now, this fourth mistake is where things get really interesting. Most people think that it doesn't matter what you bluff with in poker, that you could have a Charizard or a Pikachu in your hand and you can just take the pot willy-nilly. While this is technically true, good bluff cards typically have tremendous odds of improving to something really good, meaning that even if your bluff fails and your opponent calls, you can still improve to something that's really great and pretend like you knew what you were doing all along. Had Le Chiffre bet this board with an ace of hearts in his hand, it would still have been a risky play given the fact that there were, you know, three other transgressions made in this hand, but even if Bond had called, there's a roughly 34% chance that Le Chiffre will improve to a flush on the river, like this, or like this, etc. If bluffing with an ace of hearts, he can even potentially hit his ace and take the pot if Bond has been calling with a nine the whole time. If these numbers are coming at you real fast, just remember that an open-ended straight draw and strong flush draws are always better bets than set mining or going for gutshot straight draws. If you're curious about the game, I'll have several resources for all levels of player in the description. With twos, the odds of improving later down the line are atrocious. Like, your odds aren't as bad as Tulsi winning the Democratic nomination. This is a dated joke! But they're pretty close. You would think, well, at least there are two twos left in the deck and that can get me a set, but one of those twos is a heart. Remember, you have two black twos. I told you those would be relevant. Meaning that if the two of hearts hits the board on the turn, your set doesn't count for jack shit because you lose to literally anyone who has a heart in their hand. We'll even get to why Bond likely has a powerful heart in his hand in a minute. This all means that even if you don't know good poker math, you can understand that one card in the deck isn't much of a safety net for an out. So the next mistake is number four. He bets with cards that have a minimal chance of improving down the line. A better bluff would involve having outs that not only have a fantastic final hand, but that also has at least 8 cards that can get you there. For those of you who are interested in higher level bluff evaluations, I'll have links in the description to how to apply blockers into your decisions as well. But including that in this kind of video would make this video like 24 minutes, and also Jonii would be running for the hills. Alright, so the final mistake here involves looking at this next part of the hand after the flop. So what's really cool so far is that we've literally only seen the first 3 cards on the flop, and we haven't seen anything else. However, for the final mistake that Le Chiffre makes, we're going to need to see how the rest of the hand plays out. So Le Chiffre bet $50,000, Bond calls, and Fukutu and Infante both fold. The turn card is a 9 of clubs. Le Chiffre then makes a $100,000 bet on the turn. So now we have the same dumb bet that Le Chiffre made, but he's done it twice in a row now. This time at least we can hit one of our twos to get paid off, especially if we hit the two of hearts and Bond has an ace or a king high flush. Will be near invincible against Bond's really high flush, which is really good in terms of payout. This is still a really bad move, but there's at least a chance we can make some of our money back in this hand. Bond calls our bet, which is not a good thing, and surely enough, the river just so happens to poop out our legendary two of hearts. Le Chiffre just got very lucky and hit his best case scenario on both the turn and the river, and has now improved to a full house, which is basically the strongest hand you can get in this situation. Le Chiffre then bets $200,000 into the pot. Now, I'm going to get a tiny bit mathematical for just a second here, because we're going to have to make some speculation to proceed with the next mistake. Because the shift's bet sizing keeps doubling, it is very likely that he's been betting about half the pot each time. This makes sense given my earlier assessment, as the open raise of $25,000 would mean that the shift bet $50,000 into $100,000, then $100,000 into $200,000, and now $200,000 into $400,000. So here's the thing about this bet, the shift just hit it huge, but he's betting so conservatively. As the best poker coach in the game, James Sweeney, always says, ask yourself what you lose by betting more aggressively. If Bond has an ace or a king of hearts, that gives him a very strong flush, so you can easily get him to call 210, 220, or even as high as $300,000. Because LeChiffre has been betting out of his bunghole, this hand is very well hidden. I know that even though I'd consider myself a very strong poker player, I don't think I'd be able to consider a full house happening on this board. So that's his final mistake. He doesn't capitalize when his bluff actually works out. When LeChiffre bets on his miracle cards, he doesn't bet on them aggressively enough to capitalize on the bluff's outcome. If you're going to bluff with outs, make sure it counts when you hit them big. So with that in mind, whenever you're making a bluff, don't be like LeChiffre. And what does LeChiffre do? 1. He bluffs on very wet boards, meaning that he doesn't evaluate what his opponent could be calling with. 2. He bluffs when there are an abundance of players in the hand, meaning that there is a greater likelihood of people continuing with something strong. Number 3. He doesn't factor his position at the table before bluffing. Late position is always better, because you always have more information. 4. He overvalues his odds of improvement if his opponents do call. Bluffing with strong, plentiful outs is always better. That way you can have a safety net if someone calls your bluff. And number 5. He doesn't capitalize on his hand when he finally gets something crazy good. In the wise words of James Sweeney, what do I lose by betting bigger? In other words, before you bluff, remember WAPOK. Yeah, sure, we'll copyright that. I hope that this quick checklist is something that you can use to make your poker games a lot more dynamic. Let me know if you want to see more poker videos like these, and if you think they'd be more entertaining, because I really like making them. I really like poker. Alright, happy fun tables, gamble responsibly, bye-bye!